एवरीवन, वेलकम टू आवर चैनल स्टूडेंट्स होम्योपैथी एंड लेट्स लर्न टुगेदर। केंट्स फिलोसॉफी इज वन ऑफ द इम्पोर्टेंट मैन्युस्क्रिप्ट्स ऑफ होम्योपैथी। अंडरस्टैंडिंग केंट्स फिलोसॉफी इंक्रीजेस वन्स डेप्थ एंड एक्यूमेन इन होम्योपैथी। इन दिस वीडियो वी विल डिस्कस एंड अंडरस्टैंड द थर्ड चैप्टर ऑफ केंट्स फिलोसॉफी, दैट इज परसेप्शन ऑफ व्हाट इज क्यूरेबल इन डिजीज, क्यूरेटिव इन मेडिसिन एंड द एप्लीकेशन ऑफ लास्ट टू द फर्स्ट। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट। Before that, if you have not yet subscribed to our channel Students Homeopathy, please subscribe it now by clicking the button at the right corner below. Also, click on the bell icon and select all so that you will not miss any of our informative, educational and interesting videos on homeopathy. So, coming to our topic. As we know, this lecture of Kent's philosophy is based on the aphorism 3 of the Organon of Medicine. Kent starts the chapter by quoting the aphorism 3 of Organon of Medicine, and in aphorism 3, the first line starts with, "If the physician clearly perceives what is to be cured in diseases." So, Kent tells that the word perceive is rightly mentioned here instead of see by Hahnemann and subsequently by the translator. Because just seeing might have indicated merely to look upon with the external eye, whereas perceiving represents to clearly understand, to capture with the mind and understanding. For example, seeing might have indicated that to see a tumor or to see a part or organ or to see the urine for the presence of albumin or sugar. And as a result, the readers may have wrongly interpreted or thought that by removing this in some mysterious way that will lead to cure. But by using the word perceive, it is indicated that Hahnemann did not regard the pathological change or the morbid anatomy as the curative indication. Then, what are the curative indications in each case of disease? According to Hahnemann, the totality of symptoms is the curative indication in each case of disease. Or it can be told that the disease is only represented or expressed by the totality of the symptoms. The totality of symptoms represents the essence of disease or represents the disorder of the internal economy. The totality is external, but it represents the internal. So the first thing is to be considered in a case is what are the curative indications? And the totality of symptoms represents the curative indications. Whereas the results of disease or the changes occurring in the tissues, for example the cancerous changes, the tumors, etc., don't form the curative indication. So, results of diseases should be excluded from curative indications. Next, Kent tells that for perceiving the disease or perceiving what is to be cured in a disease, the physician need to understand the idea of the government and law. So here, what is government and law? Here, simply the government means which governs the organism or the man in health or disease. And the law means the law of direction of disease progression or cure. To explain this, he gives the example of a spider. How a spider remains in the center of the web and governs his universe from the center. Also, he compares this with the political government. If the political government in the center is weak, it leads to anarchy in the periphery. So, every government is from the center to the circumference. And he tells, in man, the center of government is in the cerebrum, and from it, every nerve cell is governed. So the disease starts from the government. And likewise, the man becomes sick, not from the external things, not from the bacteria, nor from the environment, but from causes in himself or causes from the within. So the disorder occurs in the vital economy, first followed by the manifestation in the form of signs and symptoms. And if the homeopath doesn't know this, he can't have a true perception of disease. Next, he tells that while perceiving what is to be cured in disease, one must proceed from generals to particulars. So, here, what is the meaning of general to particular? General to particular means the effect of the disease should be known generally, means the disease should be known in regard to the whole human race, or what are the common symptoms it produces on the most of the patient or the most general features of the disease. And particular means the effect of the disease on the particular individuals, or the peculiarities of the disease which are not found in most of the patients. He beautifully explains this with the example of the epidemic. In an epidemic, the picture of the disease cannot be formed just from a few cases. First of all, a physician closely observes several cases, notes down all the symptoms in a schematic form, arranging the symptoms under different headings such as mind, head, chest, etc., and forms a collective image. Then he places opposite each symptom a number corresponding to the number of patients in which that symptoms occurred. For example, aching in bones found in 20 patients, irritation in the eyes found in 10 patients, and dry cough found in 14 patients, etc. In this way, a portrait of the disease is formed, and in this portrait, there may be many symptoms which are found in almost all of the patients, and there may be some symptoms or few symptoms which are just confined to some individuals. So, all the symptoms which are found in most of the patient are the pathognomonic symptoms. The pathognomonic symptom means the symptoms of disease, or more specifically we can tell the common or general symptoms of the disease, or symptoms which help for the diagnosis of the disease. On the other hand, the symptoms which are rare or found in some or few individuals are the peculiarities of the different people or the peculiar symptoms of the given case. So, coming back to the epidemic example, after forming the totality or the picture of the disease or epidemic, the general remedies corresponding to the symptoms finalized. And after reportation, 6 to 7 remedies can be finalized for the given epidemic and called as the group of epidemic remedies for that particular epidemic. But here, question may arise, what is the remedy for each individual case? Kent tells, to select the remedy for an individual case or for a particular patient, the physician has to go through the Matra Medica and can match the individual or specific symptoms to get individual pictures and select the specific remedy from the group of epidemic remedies. In this way, he proceeds from generals to particulars, and this should be done for all cases, not only for the epidemic. Can tell, this is the only way a homeopath can proceed. There is no other way to proceed in homeopathy for selection of remedy. He tells, every patient has a certain state of peculiarities that identifies him as an individual patient. Also, every remedy has certain peculiarities that identify it as an individual remedy, and only in this way the remedy can fit to the patient. Moreover, he tells that in the epidemic, the remedy may not be always from the shortlisted group of epidemic remedies. If none of these fit to the patient, the physician must return to the original anamnesis. Anamnesis here simply means the history of the patient and select a medicine. Next, Kent tells, if immense hard work is done at the beginning of an epidemic, then rest becomes very easy. That means one can select the remedy very easily. Kent suggests that if the physician not doing this with pen and paper, he must do it in the mind, but it will be difficult with a large number of patients. Kent tells how he used to use paper or refer notes initially, but later he managed with mind or memory. Kent tells that similar to a case of the epidemic, we can easily get a group of remedies for the disease like typhoid, measles, but still he warns that the physician should not go by the names of the disease, rather he should only go by the symptoms. Also, the physician should never get crammed to this group of remedies or never get confined to a group of remedies, because every now and then we will get cases where we have to go outside of this group of remedies, and we should do that without any hesitation. Kent tells that phosphorus, rustux, brownia, baptisia, arsenic, etc. produces symptoms like typhoid condition or matches to the group of remedies for typhoid. But the list should not be always exclusive, and the physician can prescribe any medicine from outside of the group of remedies as per the signs and symptoms. Likewise, symptoms of pulsatilla may be very similar to the nature of measles, but it doesn't mean that each and every case of measles will need pulsatilla. For scarlet fever also, the prominent medicine may be ailanthus, apis, belladonna and sulfur, but it doesn't mean that the physician must prescribe from this group. He has often to go outside for this group. He also tells that in homeopathy, one remedy should not be prescribed for all of the patients suffering from same disease or of the diagnostic name. He tells even in a family, all members may need different medicine for the same disease conditions. So the physician should not prescribe basing on the name of the disease or diagnosis. But the physician should be well versed with the nature of the disease. For example, scarlet fever, measles, typhoid fever, gymnosis or other infectious disease, etc. He should know that the typhoid fever may progress to tympanic abdomen, diarrhea, continued fever, rash, delirium and unconsciousness. And these things stand out in a case of a typhoid fever, and if the physician keeps in mind these things, he can make a list of suitable group of medicine for typhoid and can easily prescribe in individual cases by referring Matra Medica. So the physician should see the disease in general as to its nature, and then when an individual has this disease, he should search for the peculiarities and prescribe accordingly. The old school physician only sees the general features of the disease, but the true homeopath, along with the general features of the disease, perceives the peculiarities or individualistic features and selects the remedy on the basis of this. These individualistic features or little peculiarities manifested by every individual patient through his inner life and through everything he thinks. Coming to the next point in the aphorism 3, if the physician clearly perceives what is curative in medicine, that is to say, in each individual medicine, then what is curative in medicines? Ken tells here, one should progress from general to particulars. Means, first the physician should get acquainted with the action of medicines collectively, then he should get acquainted with the action of medicine individually. That means, proceeding from a collective study to a particular. He tells that this can be done by studying provings. For example, in the proving of some unknown drug, each individual prover will bring out his own peculiarities or own set of symptoms. Prover number 1 might bring out the symptoms of the mind more clearly than prover number 2. Or prover number 2 might bring out the symptoms of the bowels more clearly than prover number 1. And may prover number 3 might bring out heel symptoms very strongly, etc. Now, if these symptoms are collected together, as if one man had proved the medicine, we would then have an image of that medicine. So, if we had 100 of provers, from the collective data we can perceive how it affected the human race or how the medicine acted as a unit. Ken tells that the nature of a remedy should be studied in a similar manner of studying the nature of the disease, as we have discussed earlier. A remedy should be studied as a whole following Hahnemann schema, means under the headings of mind, head, chest and so on throughout the entire body. And he tells that a remedy cannot be considered as fully proved until it has permeated and made sick all regions of the body or produced symptoms of all parts of the body. So Kane tells many of our provings are only fragments or partial provings, and these are mentioned in the books in regard to the important symptoms or the organs they affect prominently. He tells the medicine proved by Hahnemann were fully proved and the symptoms have been brought out upon the entire man. So each individual medicine must be studied in this way to know the changes it produces on the human race. Kane tells that in similar manner, Hahnemann has discovered the miasm psora. For 11 years, he collected the symptoms of those patients who were undoubtedly psoric and arranged them in a schematic form until the nature of this great miasm became apparent. He tells it is also similar in regard to syphilis and psychosis. So in this way, Kane tells that when the physician understands the nature of the disease, or when he is acquainted with every disease to which we are subject, and when he understands the nature of the remedies commonly used, then by just listening to the patient or the symptoms of a sick man, the remedies will come to his mind instantly. So, this is what the aphorism 3 or lecture 3 of Kant's philosophy teaches us. This makes the homeopathic physician so intelligent that he goes to the bedside of a patient, he can clearly perceive the nature of the disease and select the remedy very easily. or simply when a physician understands the nature of the disease and that of remedies, he becomes skillful. So now summarizing the things. A homeopathic physician not just sees, but he perceives. Pathological changes or end results are not the curative indications. The totality of the symptoms are the curative indication in each case of disease. To perceive disease properly, a homeopath should understand that disease starts from within and disease progresses from the center to circumference. To perceive what is to be cured in disease, one must proceed from general to particular. Like in cases of the epidemic, homeopaths should proceed from collective image to individualistic features to understand diseases. Pathognomonic symptoms are the general symptoms of disease which helps for diagnosis. Every patient has a certain state of peculiarities, also every remedy has certain peculiarities, and only in this way the remedy can fit to the patient. While understanding medicine or what is curative in medicine, one should also proceed from general to particular. When a physician understands the nature of the disease and that of remedies, he becomes skillful. So that's all for this video. If you have not yet subscribed to our channel Students Homeopathy, please subscribe it now. Also click on the bell icon and select all so that you will not miss any of our informative, educational and interesting videos on homeopathy. And please provide your valuable feedback in the comment section below. And also we will love to answer your queries on this topic. Thank you for watching.